C'est étrange. Je ne sais pas ce qui m'arrive ce soir. Je te regarde comme pour la première fois.
Hey guys, welcome to Let's Talk Venture, the podcast dedicated to travelers, backpackers and explorers with thousands of stories. My name is Tony and today I'm talking with Joanna and Lauren, two young women who came to France as English teacher assistant in high schools. Together, we talk about the English assistant program and how they got into it, their accommodation to France, way of living, and how they emerged themselves as foreigners from Australia and England, and some funny stories about teaching English to high school students. So here we go, let's talk venture with random conversations.
Are you recording, young lady?
Thank you!
Joanna and Lauren.
Yeah.
How are you?
Very good, thanks. How are you, Tony?
I'm fine. I'm a little bit... I like this kind of interview in the morning where I'm like, okay, refocus. Refocus your brain. It's going to be all right. Can you introduce yourself, please?
My name is Joanna, and I'm from Melbourne in Australia. And I'm currently living in France as an English assistant working in Les Vosges.
I'm Lauren. I'm 20 years old. I'm from England, from a city called Norwich, which is in the east of England, and I'm currently staying in Metz as an English language assistant in high school.
So just because, how did you meet together? How did you know to each other?
So at the start of the year, there was a stage d'accueil, like a welcome training day for all the assistants in Grand Est. Mm-hmm. And we just happened to sit next to each other, got chatting.
And then we bonded over the fact that we both do tap dancing.
Yeah.
What is tap dancing?
Tekit.
No?
and so we bonded over the fact that we both do tap dancing. And so then...
Yeah. Cool. And we have a lot of other stuff in common.
Yeah.
We've just kind of met up on various weekends.
Yeah.
You will meet to meet each other.
Yes.
No, you were destined
to meet. Yeah.
Destined to meet each other. Okay. How did you know about this program? Like, how did it happen to be an assistant in English assistant?
So for me, I'd heard about the program a few years ago. I think at my university they sort of advertised it, and it's something I've wanted to do for a few years.
Yeah.
But I never had the courage to actually go and do it. And then finally, I just bit the bullet and made it happen. So for me, coming from Australia, it's run through the French and Australian embassies. They have an agreement, and so they sort out all the visa and everything for me to come. And it's 7 months of teaching English in French high school.
Cool.
So that's how it happened for me. I just sort of found out about it through uni and then eventually found the courage to come and do it.
Yeah, mine is a bit different. So because I study French and international relations at university, but because I study French, you have to spend your third year abroad, and you can get a job, study in a university, or do an assistantship. So I chose to do an assistantship, and basically there's this organisation called the British Council that you apply to, and they take applications from kind of all over Britain, but also I think Europe as well, and they can send you to, you know, like Venezuela, Switzerland, Canada, like all over the world. It depends what language you're doing. So I picked France, and then they just kind of send you to a region, and you can select, oh, I would prefer to work with high schools and stuff like that. So, yeah. And it's the same contract.
Okay.
Yeah, so we've come from sort of a different direction, but it's the same contract now.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's the same job.
So how many people were with you in the welcoming...
We had like a lot of... There were some who weren't English assistants, weren't there? There were some Spanish.
Some Spanish, some Italian. I think... How many of us were there in total?
Like 150?
Yeah.
Wow!
And that's just in the contest. And so there's...
No way!
Yeah. So there's lots of other assistants who are in other regions in France.
Yeah.
It's quite... Yeah.
But if you think about how many schools there are,
yeah,
and
exactly.
Like Lyon, how many high schools will there be? I don't know, like 10.
There'll be a bunch of assistants here.
So,
Lyon was actually my first preference, because we had to put down three sort of, they're like the departments, the educational departments. My first preference was Lyon. My second preference was Besançon, My third
really?
Preference,
Besançon?
Yeah, and then my third preference was Nancy-Metz. I ended up with Nancy-Metz. But
yeah.
I actually love the town that I'm in.
Yeah.
Mm. It's really
yeah.
cool.
I wanted to go to Guadeloupe. So.
Yeah.
What? To where?
I wanted to go to Guadeloupe.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
But I got sent to Metz. But it's really
a bit
nice.
Different too.
But it's fine because I've been to France lots of times,
mm.
but never really the east. So it's cool to
yeah.
experience this.
The
part.
Mountain, the
yeah, the Vosges.
And
so beautiful.
Yeah, and it's really nice, like having the excuse to visit the Vosges and see Joanna.
Yeah.
Because sometimes in a city you just feel a bit like,
yeah.
so it's nice to
mm.
see a bit more of the countryside.
No, I'm very happy in the town that I've ended up in. It's a nice size because. It's big enough that it doesn't feel completely dead.
Yeah.
But it's small enough that it still feels a bit like a community.
Mm.
Yeah.
And the advantage is it has the TGV that will go straight to Paris. So I can get
no
to
way.
Paris in 3 hours
yeah.
from Pommiermont, which is like a town with 8,000 people in it.
Hmm.
But I'm just well connected to capital. So, that's
so
kind of,
cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like perfect for me because it's really beautiful scenery and everything,
mm.
the mountains and
yeah.
all the forests. It's lovely.
Just be curious, why Besançon?
I don't know, I just had this thing, I wanted to go somewhere sort of mountainy in the east, and...
You could have picked Strasbourg, or...
But, like, Strasbourg is part of the Nancy-Metz kind of
okay.
Region.
Okay.
region, yeah, so you don't get to pick a specific town,
yeah.
it's just, like, the region
mm.
surrounding
yeah.
Besançon, or the region surrounding me, or the region surrounding me.
Talking about Besançon, Strasbourg, this kind of east part of France,
yeah.
did you notice the French accent over there?
Yes.
In the Vosges, yes, there's a bit of, like, patois that gets
yeah.
in there as
yes.
well.
Yeah.
Also, the... Instead of saying vin, they'll say vins, with the like they pronounce the T
yeah,
on
yeah.
the end of 20. And there's a few things
yeah.
I have noticed.
I haven't massively heard it, I guess, because every time I don't come to France loads, but every time I think you just adapt to the
yeah, whatever
language
accent
you're
hearing.
Hearing
yeah.
And those nuances sometimes I would have to have spoken to someone earlier, like in the week or something, and then realised that they're speaking
mm.
in a different. It's obvious here, like in the south, when we came,
south,
and you hear.
Yeah.
Well,
the,
you know, I mean,
the, okay,
the south.
I think the conductor on the train,
yeah.
I think, must have been from Marseille.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's why, because he was like.
What was it?
What
it was like,
ma,
I don't know what sounds. It was just like sounds coming
saying,
out.
Like, eh.
It was like, it was like devant.
Yeah, it was like
yeah.
avant, avant trente.
Yeah.
Avant
yeah.
Anyway,
it's a bit different, but it's good.
No, even us French, we love the South. It depends on people, but me personally, even every time I hear someone with a South accent from Marseille or Toulouse,
yeah.
I hear the sunlight and the,
yeah.
the
yeah.
crickets.
yeah, you hear summer.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's nice. You know, it's nice to get to a level of French where you can sort of hear different accents,
yeah.
because for a long time it was like all French just sounds like, you know,
mm.
just noise. And so then to get to a point where not only
yeah.
you can sort of understand, but you can understand the differences,
yeah.
that's very satisfying as a language learner.
Yeah. But do you find it a little bit more complicated to the different accents? Is it the same thing for me as the Scottish accent where it's a little bit complicated to guess?
I don't think it's as
nothing's as bad as the
not
Scottish
as extreme.
I love the Scottish accent.
Because I went to, I did an exchange in Perpignan, and that was fine. Like, I could understand people.
Yeah.
yeah.
And I think, especially when you're learning, you don't have this, like, concrete, this is what the French accent sounds like.
Yeah, it's a bit
so
more fluid.
So you just kind of, whatever context you're in, you're just trying to work out what they're saying, and I think you adapt. So I don't think it's as bad as English accents.
yeah, I think for me, most people I speak to in French now understand okay, but then very occasionally in my little town I'll cross paths with someone who's like very much from like a more sort of rural part, and like their accent might just be extra strong, and then
yeah.
if they speak really quickly I am completely lost.
yeah.
But I think generally it's okay. It's sort of the occasional person I'll cross paths with where I'm like, okay, cool, I don't speak French. I don't understand French at all, that's fine. I've been learning it for a long time and I know nothing, that's fine. My ego
yeah.
is fine. yeah. something.
If you want some reassurance about that, mm-hmm. sometimes if I go through a north part countryside, I don't even understand them.
What do they call it? Ch'ti, is that
the... Oh, the ch'ti, yes.
Yeah, that's right. I know there's that film that's like Bienvenue chez les ch'tis,
yes.
Something like that. Yeah. We studied that at some point, I think.
Studied the movie?
Well, we didn't study it, no. It was in a translation class, and they were like, how would you translate the title of this film? Because it's such a regionally specific title. Like, no, you can't say the ch'ti. Like, people don't know what that is if you're trying to translate it into English. How do you...
Yeah.
And so we were arguing about how you could translate. I think we came up with like "Welcome to the Sticks."
Yeah.
That kind of has a similar sound to it, but the sticks can also just mean like basically a rural area.
Yeah, you're like they live out in the sticks. It's like they live just like out in the middle of nowhere in like the countryside.
Yeah.
Reference the sticks kind of references nature.
Yeah, I think it's trees.
Yeah.
Probably is where the sticks
maybe.
Yes. There you go, there's a little language thing for
me. Thank you. But just to make you more understood that the Ch'ti language is a dialect.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's a dialect. As well as in the west of France, La Bretagne, they also have a dialect.
Yeah.
That only written people understand and don't always know how to speak that.
Yeah,
and also in the north, they don't all know how to speak
Ch'ti. Yes, and I think that, because I went to Montpellier a couple of years ago, and I think that they like used to have like a dialect that was very common there and is sort of dying.
Mm-hmm.
There's hardly anybody who can speak it anymore, and so they're trying to revive dialect a little bit. Try to save it.
Yeah, I think that's happening a lot, but I'm actually spent not last summer, but the summer before that, so 2018, I worked in Brittany in a campsite, kind of near Pont-à-Bourg, kind of near there, and you were just kind of more aware of like the dialect on the names of like restaurants and stuff. And it's funny because my mum is from Wales, and because both of the origins of the people are the Celts, like the Gaels, like the Gaelic, so it's the same people. So the words are very similar. So tea, like T-Y means house, and that was also the name of a lot of like restaurants, like tea something. My sister came to visit and she was like, why is there Welsh everywhere? And I was like, because it's the same, it's very similar.
Yeah, that's so
it's
awesome.
Very interesting.
Mm. Why France? Why France?
I mean, the reason that I'm in France is because I learned French at university. But the reason that I started learning French, the only reason I started French was because in primary school, I learned German, but I hated my German teacher. Hated her. And so then so in Australia, you start going to high school when you're like 12 or 13. And so when I went to high school, I had the choice between studying French or German. But because I had hated my German teacher so much in primary school, I chose French. So really, the only reason I'm here now is because of my terrible German teacher in primary school. That's like, if you look at the cause and effect, so thank you, Frau Wood, wherever you are, for being a terrible teacher.
I'm not sure, but which one is the most complicated? Is it the German grammar, which is more complicated than the French grammar? Or?
I don't know. I never got very far in German because I didn't like my teacher.
Well,
I think French is quite complicated.
Yeah, German has cases. So I think once you get over that, you're fine. I think it's like nominative, accusative.
Have you ever
heard it?
No, I have not. That sounds yucky. I don't want to.
Yeah, but I think French grammar, when you start like getting to a really high level, which is what my uni wants me to be right now, and I'm having to do exercises like exactly when you use the subjunctive and like and all the nuances of when you use a instead of de or on, like in terms of countries, then it's just nuts. It's crazy. It's quite complicated. So.
But there was a thing like an image on the internet showing that if you see a French book, which is a specific size, like for example 10 centimeter number of pages wide, if you take off all the letters that we don't pronounce in the French things, is just reduced to from 10 to 2 centimeters.
That sounds about right.
Because if you take off the NT,
and the ENT.
At the end, or the S sometimes. Yes.
That's so
E A U O.
Yeah.
And X at the end, still O.
Yeah.
That's so true.
Yeah. I think that the like learning the pronunciation in French is.
Yeah. And also there's this video on internet, I don't know if you saw that, about an American who is trying to explain how us in France we count. Like he's saying, what the fuck? Like, so it's okay until you are at 16, so it's 16, and then suddenly you pass to 17, and instead of saying you say 17.
Don't get me started on
80.
I literally maps every time.
And then it's like 96, like I'm born in 1996, so I have to say that a lot, and I'm just like, what?
That took a while.
4/20/16, stop.
The worst thing is
the dates. I've learned French for so long, I still can't do numbers.
The worst thing is the dates when it's like, male, nef, sol, cap, tan, says, and you're like, okay, here we go, male.
Yeah,
one,
I was nine, like, I
take
a big breath, and then I'm like, okay, here we go.
But like, it's
a nightmare.
I know as well, like, the way you say numbers. You're like, count, okay, count, count, and then it's like, special disset, and you're like, 77, and then they've already said the three other numbers.
Yeah,
like
they're suddenly saying their phone number. You're like, yeah, cool, cool, cool. And then there's something that's like 70 and above, and you're like, no.
Yeah.
I need like a good 10 seconds to like process that and realize.
But I discovered that a few years ago that apparently we are only the France who does that.
And yeah, in Switzerland, they
and
don't.
In Belgium, they don't do that.
In Canada,
yeah.
They don't. They've got like 7 ans.
Yes, 7 ans, 8 ans,
yeah.
That's the thing. Like we, in France, when we say that, people in France say, "Why do they do that? It's not normal. It's us who are not normal to say."
It's l'Académie Française who have the, you know.
Yeah, l'Académie Française who hate like all the United Nations.
Yeah. No. Yeah. No. It's there's definitely quirks in the French language, but I mean English is a nightmare.
So glad I didn't have to learn English.
I feel like English, I think, I know, having been working as an English assistant and realizing how hard it is to learn English as a second language, I think that...
You think?
Yeah.
Well, I think that it's like, you can get to a workable level of English maybe fairly quickly, but then there's just so many exceptions.
Yeah.
I feel like there's more exceptions than there are rules.
Oh, you are
English.
Talking about the verb like do, did.
All those
and
sorts
it's more
of things.
Like a lot of pronunciation. There's not rules, so O U G H. You can pronounce that 10 different ways. You know, you have enough, or you have more like. Where you've got a fat, or you've got like though, which is more like an
thought.
O, and you've got like thought, or you've got thorough, where you pronounce it like an O, and so it's just, there's a lot of things like English syntax, which are just our rules, and you have to just learn it.
But yeah, I don't know, because I've never had to like learn English, you know?
Yeah, I have the same, I don't know, I felt it's more easier to like mostly the grammar, like how to use verb in English, so simple. But
the
French and the Spanish, for example.
Yeah, I've learned a bit of Spanish as well.
I made the comparison, like it was so quicker to learn the English verb than to learn the Spanish verb because I realized that there's this variation because you use in this time with this subject and everything, so I have lived in China for 1.5 years, and there I have tried without formation to teach French to Chinese kids. Oh my god!
do you speak Chinese?
I used to. I had an okay level, but the most of the lesson I was translating from English to French because they had an okay level of English to teach them French, but I think I was a terrible I was a okay teacher in terms of I like to do games to teach them, but in terms of practical, like from what they have tried to teach them,
yeah.
I don't think they will remember a lot of things.
Yeah.
What I find interesting is a lot of the things that French students find difficult in learning English is the thing I found difficult learning French, like the difference.
Mm-hmm.
Because ultimately you're coming, like I find it difficult having this role and then leaping into like the French way.
Mm.
And the French have like difficulty saying something that they're used to,
yeah.
saying it my way. So I can really understand when they're having trouble,
yeah.
like what's the problem, because I've faced the same thing.
Mm.
And it's really interesting that it's normally like the same thing, whether that's like using more verbs instead of a noun. Like, is it French people that love nouns?
Yeah.
Yeah, they just love nouns for like everything. So instead of, and then British people, we use verbs. So it's kind of like that as well.
Yeah.
Did you have a formation to teach English?
So we had this, yeah, so it's a, we had a very brief training in we were all, like in the, we went to Nancy, that was where we met.
It was like 2 hours.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, basically the assumption is like, okay, you're fluent in English, you're like, you to be part of this program, you have to like be born in an English speaking country or have like,
really?
Like be completely fluent.
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
And so, but like that's the point of it is like, it's not that you're there to be an English teacher per se, you're an English assistant. And so you're there, your role is to be a native speaker, really.
Yeah,
and so you're supposed to, your main role is to get the students to talk, which is really hard. And also to share your culture.
Yeah.
And so it's not so much like, we don't have to know all the English grammar sort of stuff necessarily. That's more the teacher.
Hmm.
It's like their role.
Okay.
And our role is more, I guess, a bit more
to
pragmatic.
Give the good pronunciation.
Yeah,
yeah,
give,
pronunciation.
And more like when we would use certain things. Because sometimes, you know, the teachers could use this correct grammar, but we could say, well, we use this situation when, we, you know, we use this grammar phrase when you're asking this question or when you're in this.
I just had this image in my mind of a Texan guy coming to France to teach English, or a Scottish person coming to France.
We have a friend who's
wow.
Scottish.
Yeah, no, it happened. And
yeah, he's
yeah, Matt.
He's
how
in,
are you?
He's in Le Vosges as well.
Yeah.
So the people in Le Vosges are being exposed to an Australian accent, to a Scottish accent.
New Zealand.
They had a couple of years ago an assistant from New Zealand at the high school that I'm at. They had a New Zealand.
Yeah, my school had, they said they haven't had a British person either ever or in the past 10 years. They've had like New Zealand, Australian, South African, American. They
yeah,
get a lot of American.
There's a lot of American people who come.
So it's just kind of that as well, and that's good for the students if every year, you know, they're introduced to a different
accent, different culture as well.
But yes, that's the point. But I'm actually doing on the side teaching English in a foreign language course, which is really helpful. So I'm having to learn all the different grammar things, like the past perfect continuous.
Yeah, these are things
the,
I don't know. I just use English. I don't understand English.
Present perfect continuous. And so I also do private lessons on the side. So I'm teaching English, which is just kind of my lessons, and it's the first time I've done it. So I'm using some information on the course as I go, as well as just I got taught French and what exercises were helpful for me in terms of learning language. But it's really cool because I get to like learn how to like plan a reading lesson and then just apply it like straight away. Or I've had trouble like teaching this one thing and then I learn it. So it's interesting.
My favourite thing is all the questions that I get about Australia. The main question I get is, have you ever seen a kangaroo? And then the immediate follow-up question when I say yes is, have you ever eaten a kangaroo?
Because
like, have you ever eaten have you ever ate a kangaroo?
Yeah.
Like that's or did you ever
did you
see a kangaroo? Like, first of all, it's a kangaroo, not a kangaroo. Yes, I've seen a kangaroo. Yes, I have eaten kangaroo, but I'm now vegetarian, so I don't eat kangaroo anymore.
I just get, so what do you think about the Brexit?
Yeah, all the questions. About I get the kangaroo questions, you get the Brexit
like,
questions.
Well, it's complicated.
Is there a limit age?
I think you have to be under 25 or something.
Yeah, you have to be above 18.
Yeah, I think it's like there's, they want like young people so that the students can sort of relate to you. And maybe it's less than 30. I think it's over 18, less than 30.
It depends.
Like,
but depends.
It's only your country of origin as well. I think for Australians it's that sort of age bracket maybe. I'm not sure.
Do you still need to be a student to do that, or you can be...
For me in Australia, yes. Okay. But I don't know
the
how
same in the UK.
Okay.
But there's other private
programs
that will be a similar role as a language assistant. So this happens to be one that's organised through the government, through the embassy sort of thing. That's what I've chosen to do. But there will be private companies who have similar things for different languages as well.
But
so you can go and be an assistant. You could be a French assistant in Australia, for example.
Yeah, or like in England, which would probably, I don't know, be more beneficial because you're still then in the country practicing English, but you're bringing that Frenchness as well.
Yeah, some Frenchness.
Yeah, because you're like, so I don't know if the reason why you wanted to do it was to practice English, the best way is to probably be in the country and teach French. Because sometimes like, the teachers normally have a good level of English, but they're just sometimes like will mispronounce something or just like miss the unknown contextual knowledge or just the syntax.
It just reminds me of a former flatmate that I have in China.
Yeah.
She was from Spain and she had some French classes, but in Belgium. And so every time she was trying to speak French, she spoke French with a Belgian accent saying, "Bonjour, je m'appelle Martha."
So my French teachers over the years have come from various different backgrounds.
Yeah.
So it's taken a while to sort of work out what my French accent sort of should sound like. Because my first French teacher was Australian. Then my second French teacher was Russian. So for a while there, I spoke French with a slightly Russian accent. And then I did have a native French speaker. I think he was from Martinique, maybe. But then I had another. I had a British guy. And then it was when I got to university that I like had my first French teacher who was from like from mainland France.
Oh, there wasn't a Canadian French teacher.
No. But my most recent French teacher was from the US, and so his French was very good, but he kind of spoke French with a bit of an American accent, and so that kind of basically sounded like Quebecois. Quebecois is a nightmare.
Oh, it's so...
It's so hard to understand for me.
It's just... me personally, I love it because it's
funny. Oh, yeah, it's, and it's different.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
You know, it's, I don't think it's good to sort of... have a hierarchy of accents necessarily, but it's just because the French that you learn at university, I don't know about you, but for me, they were very much trying to get you to learn like a Parisian French sort of thing, and so then it's just hard to understand other accents sometimes,
yeah.
Like we were saying earlier.
I think it's because you're in Australia, obviously, less French people go to Australia.
Yeah.
So I had like English teachers at my school, but then when I went to university, French, like native speakers. And it was funny because I had one French professor who, when she spoke English, she spoke with a Scottish accent because she had learned, kind of done her year abroad in Scotland. So
That was
really weird. But yeah, interesting. I went to Burkina Faso for a month once, but spoke French there. So that was interesting, like getting used to that accent. It's very different.
Yeah.
But like once you do, it's fine. And you can
understand.
Yeah.
Since you are here, when did you arrive in France? September.
Yeah. For me, it was like the last week of September.
Okay.
I arrived in Paris. I stayed in Paris for a week with my girlfriend, and then I headed over to Les Vosges.
Yeah.
Got there at the start of October.
Yeah, I arrived, it's the 21st of September.
Yeah.
But I have been home for 2 weeks.
So how do you manage, like, how to say this question? How did you make friend? Like,
Well, I mean, the training happened reasonably early on, and so that's where we got the opportunity to meet other assistants. And I think that's probably been the main, because in the town that I'm in, there's not very many young people.
No.
There's sort of the high school age students, and I think most of them, as soon as they finish high school, they leave.
Yeah.
And then there'll be the teachers who are mainly like 30 or 40 and above. But then there's this big age bracket of people my age. I'm 23. I'm like, where are the 23-year-olds in this entire town? I don't know where they are.
They flee.
Yeah. Which would be different at Mess because there's a university and there's a few more people
for
around.
For me, I haven't got like loads of friends, but I'm in like a co-loc, like a flat share with other people. So there's one French person who's like one of my closest friends, and then one Mexican person, but they speak French, but they're never really around. But luckily, because I was lucky that they introduced me to things. So for example, Mexican guy Willie, he said, oh, I go to like a university Bible study group every Wednesday, you can come if you want. I'm not Christian, but I'm very familiar. And I was like, you know what, you've got nothing to lose, you don't know anyone, let's go. So that was really helpful. So I've met people through that, and then been to like a couple of parties, and we've had some games nights, and now it's kind of hosted at our house. So, and I also like do some, like a girl comes to my house and we do like some fitness videos on YouTube for an hour. Which is nice.
Yeah.
Says, why is that funny?
Sorry. No, it's good. It's good. Sorry.
And then also like, my friend Matt then introduced me to like a couple of their friends, or like they'd say, oh, I'm going to North Sea to this concert, do you want to come? So I've done a bit. This kind of term since January, I've spent quite a few weekends by myself, but I think that's also part of the process of this experience, is kind of learning like, oh, what do I actually want to do with this? This is the most spare time I've ever had in my life, and I'm like, What do I do with it? What do I want? Because I'm used to, I kind of went from school, which I did a lot, to like university, which I did extracurricular activities. So now it's the first time where it's kind of, you can do what you want. There's no one really telling you. You just got to make sure you turn up for work and that's it.
It's cool. So the contract is only 12 hours a week.
Yeah, exactly. So.
Wow. Okay.
And I know that you have actually 12 hours a week, but for me, my school is terrible at actually giving me hours. So I think on average, I've probably had about maybe 8 hours work a week.
Wow.
There's some weeks where I've been given like 5 hours and that's all. And so then it's just like, I just have all of this free time. I get paid the same amount at the end of the month, regardless of how many hours they give me. It was written in the contract that I get 12. It's their fault if they don't actually ask me to come. But I think similar thing, this is, so in Australia, I live with my parents still. Because while studying, it's just easier because my university is quite close to home. Easier and cheaper. Also, I like my parents. I like my family. So this is the first time I've lived out of home. And it's overseas, and I'm living alone. So it's kind of all in one hit, which has actually been so great. I love living alone. But I think it's going to be a problem because now I probably can't afford to live alone. If I go back to Australia, like if I wanted to move out, I'd move into some sort of house share situation. But I don't know how I'd go, because now I got so used to just having my own space and being able to organise everything how I want.
Flat share is just the most amazing thing.
Yeah?
Because it's you are with people from the same stage of life as you, if you are lucky. So if you want to party, you organize yourself together to agree to do a party, and then once you want to, and if you want to be with people or having company, you can go to the living room or the kitchen and share a moment with someone. And then once you want to be by yourself, you just go to your room.
Yes.
Yeah. Otherwise, like, if you live alone, if you want to meet someone, there is no one to see.
Yeah.
So that's
true.
That's
I'm quite lucky in the fact that, I mean, I love people, but I also really, I really enjoy being alone.
Yeah.
I'm quite comfortable being alone.
Mm.
And so I guess I'm lucky. I think if I didn't have that kind of personality, I would feel just very lonely all the time.
Yeah.
But I'm quite happy just to, you know, just be in my own space, cook myself a meal, and then if I want to see people, go and make that happen.
I'm more of like a person who needs people, so it's definitely been helpful having a flat, like, share. But it's nice as well, like, had to pay a lot of money in Mess, so it's really nice. and yeah, it's not with lots of people. I couldn't live with like 8 people, it's too much. But you know, 2 or 3 is a good number.
But did you know this person before?
No.
No, okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, everything was like new. I didn't know anyone when I was coming. So that's been like
okay.
A good challenge.
I think my my main friend in my town is a 72-year-old retired maths teacher. His name is Jean-Pierre, because of course his name is Jean-Pierre. And I refer to him as my French grandfather, and he refers to me as his French granddaughter.
Aww.
Yeah, he's my FGF.
Your what?
French grandfather. He made that joke one day, and I just thought it was hilarious. But we mainly speak in French together, which is really nice. But he used to help out the assistants when they came to the high school. And now that he's retired, he still does it because he just has more time to offer than the other teachers because they're busy teaching.
Yeah.
And so he helped me settle in when I first arrived, setting up a bank account, all the French administration that we and yeah, so we'll go out for dinner and stuff together. And he's a very sweet, very sweet person. I'm very glad that I've got him. He's been my rock. I'm gonna miss JP.
I think it really depends, you know, everyone, there's this talk about the year abroad experience, but I think for everyone it's so different. It depends where you are, who you're living with, what type of person you are, like, what kind of stage you're at in your life, you know, because, you know, there are more things I could, if I wanted to, I could go out every Thursday and Friday and go out to clubs or whatever and meet people that way, but that's not who I am and what I want to do, so I do things like, I'm also in a choir and stuff, so it's just kind of.
Yeah, I think it's like being authentic to you and what you want your experience to be, rather than setting up some expectation of, oh, like, I'm just going to party all year because that's what everyone does. But I think my sort of goal for the last sort of time that we have, like, because our contract finishes at the end of April. Then we've got we're on school holidays now, which is why we've travelled to Lyon. And then there's another school holidays at the end of April, so we only have about 6 weeks left of actual teaching.
No, you will not be here in May. I don't remember if it's May or April, but there is a month with a lot of holiday, jours fériés.
I'd say public holiday.
Public holiday.
I think bank holiday is a very British thing.
Oh, really?
Bank holiday. I just say a public holiday.
Bank holiday. No, I'm joking.
We disagree on the English language quite a lot.
Yeah,
I think the main offender for me is, like, for me, these are pants.
Yeah.
Trousers.
And for Lauren, they're trousers.
Trousers.
For her, pants are underwear.
Yeah.
So,
also,
so that can cause some confusion.
And low-key annoys some people, the sea, the ocean. Because the ocean is a bigger, like the Pacific Ocean. But when you go, it's like you go swim in the sea.
Oh, yeah.
Ah.
I mean, I think I just like to say the ocean to make it feel more dramatic.
So I've maybe said the word ocean like less than 100 times in my life.
Okay, but like, so panties is pants?
So for me, I'd say, you can say panties or I'd just say underwear. I'd say underwear.
Okay.
Or undies.
Panties, that word is awful. Like...
I say undies probably most often. I don't know if that's an Australian shortening of underwear.
I say pants,
or if that's
a lot of British people say knickers.
Do American people say underwear?
They say what?
Knickers.
Knickers?
Knickers.
Knickers?
K-N-I-C-K-E-R.
Like Snickers without the S.
Yes.
What?
With the silent K, like knight or knife. Yeah, like knickers or like underwear.
Okay, I didn't know this word.
Or pants.
Yeah. It's very important vocabulary to have. But yeah, in Australia, I'd say underwear or undies. And I'm not sure if undies is a specifically Australian shortening of underwear or not. So we often shorten things. Well, I mean, everyone does, but I could do it more.
Oh, this moo you two have.
Yes,
okay. I like to finish the interview where we are. Do you have any stories about your English... stories, English teaching story, experience so far.
Stories about
Except from, did you eat a kangaroo? Did they ask you if you have eaten something strange in England?
No.
Because we are quite focused on food here.
Yes. Yes.
I know that like people are very keen to say that British food is awful. I'm like, okay, but also you eat kebabs all the time, so who?
Kebab is not French.
Yeah, but you know what I mean. It's kind of, and a lot of English food has kind of moved on from the traditional, like, I don't know. Lots of people eat fish and chips and like roast, but and now British food is like curries from, you know, lots of food from India and stuff like that. So it's like, it's not just, I don't know, potatoes and meat anymore. Mm.
Mm.
So yeah, but people ask if I drink tea or not. Well, not, it was one of the questions, which is true. British people do like drinking tea. But
7 p.m. all the time.
Yeah. Trying to think of if there's any particularly amusing sort of moments in class. One of my favourite things to do with the students is I have a jar of Vegemite.
Of what?
Vegemite. Have you heard of Vegemite before?
What is a Vegemite?
Have you heard of Marmite?
The black thing,
yeah,
so
it's spread. So
the
Marmite,
salty, it's super salty thing.
Yeah, yeah. So Marmite comes from the UK, and the Australian version is Vegemite. Vegemite's better. You're wrong. but I have a jar that I bring into class with me. When I introduce Australia, I introduce a few foods and things, and I get the students to smell the Vegemite, and their reactions are just classic, because I work in a lycée and a collège as well, and so particularly at the collège, they're just like, oh, ça pue, oh, c'est dégueulasse, like, it's just like, their reactions are just the best, whereas I'm like, this is delicious, how dare you, this is my national pride. But no, it's very funny to watch French people reacting to Vegemite. I appreciate there's a bunch of YouTube videos that are just that, like, French people reacting to Vegemite.
I have, like, a weird... The funniest, like, one of the funniest things, it's probably not very funny, that a French person has said, it's like a language thing. So a girl was talking, doing a presentation in English about Halloween, and she's like, yeah, one of my favourite things to do on Halloween is to, like, sit down with my friends, like, watch a scary film and have a salad bowl of sweets. And I was like, a salad bowl?
Of sweets?
Doesn't make any sense, because in French, a big bowl is a saladier. So I found that funny.
Yeah.
Probably
yeah.
Isn't that funny, but I found that
but, like,
funny because it's just like...
It's a linguistic kind of...
Because sweets
difference.
And salads are like the opposite.
Yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying?
Big bowl of sweets?
So she was trying to... She wanted to say a big bowl of sweets. Like my favourite thing is to
like
say
a big bowl of candies?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, she like that's what she wants to do.
Yeah.
Like, but she had used Google Translate or something and just typed in saladier,
mm-hmm.
and it came up with salad bowl.
Oh, salad bowl.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So like, she was saying like, I have a salad bowl of sweets.
Oh.
I was like, don't think that's quite...
Yes. Right. Sweets don't really belong in your salad. I think there's been any like... Oh, my favourite thing is when I ask... I often ask the students if they know any Australian music, and then I'm like, you know, AC/DC, Sia.
They are Australian?
AC/DC are Australian, yeah. And everyone's always shocked. I'm like, well, educate yourself. Anyway, but in return, I've been asking them for some French recommendations of music, and the one that comes up without fail is Joule. And
for
so,
the people listening who doesn't know Joule, just type G U L. Don't blame me.
Oh, it's
blame
J U L.
J U L.
Yeah.
On m'appelle l'OVNI.
So they, whenever I tell them that I know who Joule is, they think that I'm the coolest person, even though Joule is trash. Apparently, I've not actually really listened to any, so I can't.
Don't inflate. Don't. Don't, ne t'inflige pas ça. Don't. Allez. Don't.
Ne t'inflige pas.
Quel verbe?
Infliger.
Infliger.
Non, je connais pas. Je suis désolée.
Don't. don't hurt yourself with that.
Oh, okay, yeah. Don't submit yourself to that.
Yeah, don't submit yourself, yeah.
Yeah, don't put yourself through that.
Oh, don't put yourself through that. Yeah.
What was the verb in prison? Infliger.
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 Oh, so like inflict.
Yes, thank you.
Inflict would be the
other.
Isn't it an
I? Spelled with an I?
Yeah. I-N-F-L-I...
G-E-R?
Yeah, G, yeah.
The G and the J, I always, whenever I try to say, like...
I always have to go, like that's how I know the difference. Because that's how I know the French alphabet. Sorry.
That's the same mistake that the French students make back the other way.
Yeah. But the biggest thing I've learned really about this experience is like French teenage boys like to play video games. They like football and they like French rap. Every time, so I do one-to-one conversations, I'm like, do you have any hobbies? And they're like, video games and football. And I'm like, who's your favourite football team? Barcelona, Messi, and I'm like, okay. And then again, like the next person, do you have any hobbies?
Same conversation.
Yeah, no, I like football. I'm like, okay. So I've literally.
Where are the nerds?
There's a couple who were like, I read, and I'm like, really? What do you read?
Yes, tell me more.
And they're like, I do like motorbiking or like fishing.
No one watched sci-fi movies or no?
Or some of them,
I like Star Wars.
Yeah!
Say, like, I love Netflix, but like,
oh my god, yeah, I get a lot of people who love Netflix.
And like,
wow, oh, this young generation. Oh.
There are some kids who are like, I suppose, quite nerdy who are into Sherlock and like movies.
Oh.
But, yeah, most of they seem very like samey. I'm like, how was your weekend? They're like, okay, played some video games, watched Netflix, slept.
That is so sad.
I just start to get sad.
Yeah, I remember my childhood with a bike all the time.
Yeah, just off adventuring.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Mm. I feel like I should have a funnier story. I just can't think of anything right now except for. I haven't had any like really. I've had some dramatic things happen. I had in a class there was a student who myself and the teacher didn't know this, but she has a type of blood disorder, which means that she like faints sometimes.
Yeah.
But she just like fainted in the back of class, and so I went and I started trying to do first aid. But all my first aid training is in English, of course, and so I'm trying to like work out how to sort of, you know, that you ask questions and stuff. So I sort of started trying to, like, put her into recovery position and that sort of thing. But then thankfully some other people came in and sort of took over because it was easier in terms of the language perspective. And they ended up, like, calling the pompier and stuff as well. Pompier, because but it turned out she was fine. If we'd known about that, like, particular blood disorder that she has, then we wouldn't have called because it's something that happens semi-regularly.
Hmm.
But I just sort of was like, what do I do in this situation? I'd never considered the fact that I might need to learn bilingual first aid. It just, you know.
Yeah,
but
that's true.
Yeah. Anyway, that was a bit of a dramatic thing that happened in class one time. Yeah.
Mostly like the biggest challenge is to get French teenagers to talk to you and not talk to each other when you're with them by yourself.
Yeah.
And just to kind of be enthusiastic about life. That's
the thing.
Not just be like, why am I here?
Have you tried to teach them some rap music?
I haven't. I've done some Australian music with them, but I haven't done any rap.
I've done some English music. They like when I talked about the Beatles and the Spice Girls. But you also have to make
Spice Girls?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Is that British? Because you have to, I did kind of a little bit of British music history, but normally we have to kind of stick to the curriculum and kind of what they're studying, which is...
A lot of, the teachers have just been getting me to talk about just a lot of Australian stuff. I've got this Australian animal bingo game that I've made, and that always goes down a treat. They love it. Whether they're at college or at the city, they all love. They all love the Australian animal bingo.
Which is?
So it's do you know bingo, the game?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I have like, what animals do I have in my bingo game?
Just
check.
So bingo is like you have a board with numbers and then there is a
So I just done it a bit differently. So instead of having numbers, I have the names of different Australian animals. But then they'll correspond to a number. And so I get them just to like pull a number out of a cup normally. And then I'll show off the picture and I'll say, okay, so what animal is this? And if it's a kangaroo, they all know what it is, but then...
Kangaroo!
Exactly. Or like, they're like, koala, and they're like, koala. They're like, koala, I'm like, no, koala. Yeah, so
I should have done that during my French classes.
Yeah.
Try to, it's hard to like try and spice things up a bit. Like,
yeah, I do like trying to use games and activities and that sort of thing.
They're like, especially like, I work with sometimes like back home, and I once did like a competition with, you know, where I was a celebrity or I had a celebrity in my head, they had to ask me questions and guess who it was, and they were getting so competitive with each other. They were like,
I love making it competitive. I also have this this lesson that I do that's like sort of France versus Australia. And so we go through things, like, it's basically to teach them about boring things in Australia, like how the government works, and like capital city and who, like those sort of, but I've just turned into a competition. So I said, okay, for example, the national animal in Australia is the kangaroo, the national animal
it,
of France.
Isn't it the bloody puff?
The what?
The duck mouth.
The platypus?
Platypus.
That platypus is, it's an animal, but like our like national emblem. Sort of, like in France, you got the rooster. And so I'm like, okay, who wins? Cockerel. Kangaroo. Cockerel, sorry.
That was so imperious that we had to go back.
Oh, you don't say rooster?
No, we say cockerel, like cock.
And how do you say it in English?
Cockerel.
I just say,
cockerel.
I'd say you
but
a rooster.
You spell it cockerel, but you say cockerel. And you say cockadoodledoo, cockerico.
So, I'm sorry, yeah, we'll stick with
rooster. Rooster. Rooster is easier. Yes, learn Australian English. It's the purest form of English. You hate me so much.
No, I'm not. I'm like trying to like not get annoyed at it. There's just different ways of speaking. None of them
are
better.
Yeah, stop being so imperialist trash.
But it's more like because it's like... If someone all your life has told you this is how you say it and then somebody says it a different way, your automatic response is to be like,
no.
Because it's like a spelling test. You're like, no, you don't spell it like that because I had to learn how to spell it this way.
Yeah, you get
and
quite
then,
stubborn.
So it's just that automatic thing of like, I don't actually think my language is more important. It's just you've learned a correct way. And then someone's saying, it's like if someone picked up a knife and said, this is called a shpanoodle. And you're like, no, it's not. It's a knife, not a shpanoodle. So,
what?
She's just making up words now, don't
that.
Worry.
Okay.
Word, don't worry.
If you want a joke to make a big debate in the class, I don't know, maybe they are a little bit too young in your classes, maybe in the university it will work. You go to some place or you try to put the bakery subject on the table and then is you see this bakery kind of bread with chocolates inside. Try it one day. To call it une chocolatine instead of pain au chocolat. Just try.
I hate in English when people or in America people say like chocolate bread or like a pain au chocolate.
Yeah, pain au chocolate.
Or they call a baguette French stick and I'm like, how dare you insult the name? They just like Englishify it.
But so, what is the English name for that?
Well, you just call it what it is. It's a baguette or a pain au chocolat.
Pain au chocolat,
yeah.
So you call it a pain au chocolat with the English accent.
You say like maybe pain au chocolat.
Pain au chocolat.
If you say the
and sometimes
Australian
when I'm
accent.
Funny, I'll be like pain au chocolat.
Yeah, pain au chocolat.
Pain au chocolat. But yeah, my mum will be like, I'm going to the
bakery.
Or like go to the supermarket, should we have croissants for breakfast? I'm like, cool, can I have a pan of chocolat, please?
Ah, okay. But one day, just try during your classes or during your teacher... not chocolatine. Chocolatine.
Chocolatine.
Just try.
Okay. Okay. You think it's a bit of a polemic issue? Yeah.
It became an internet meme.
Oh, really?
Like, really...
Are
there
different parts of France?
If you look on the map of France, like, every... everywhere in France they call it pain au chocolat, but there is one part in the southwest of France where they say chocolatine.
Really? In Bordeaux?
Yeah. Not in Bordeaux, in Toulouse. Toulouse, Biarritz, this
part. Yeah, like the very sense.
Yeah.
I'm not even French.
And it's just. Now, people may take it very, very seriously, but me, it's just like an occasion to create a fight.
Yeah.
So, yeah, just try one.
Yeah.
Do you want to add something to end the interview?
Thank you. It's been a nice chat. I always love talking to people who have like learnt multiple languages. And when you have multiple languages in common, it's just nice to. That's what you get when you open your mind a little bit and travel outside of your comfort zone a little bit.
Yeah,
it's nice.
Thank you. You and if anyone is listening has found this interesting.
Because
it's our lives.
Thank you very much. See you.
Bye-bye.
Je te regarde comme pour la première fois. A big thanks to Joanna and Lauren who have accepted to talk with me during this episode. Thanks also to the Alto Hostel and his staff for letting me record the podcast. And thank you for listening to it. And you can also find other episodes of Let's Talk Venture on YouTube, Spotify, Deezer, Apple Podcasts, PodCloud, and the Internet Archive. You can also find my adventure on Instagram and Facebook, and all the links will be in the descriptions. And if you like this episode, please share it and talk about it around you. Don't forget to subscribe, leave a thumbs up and 5 stars, and I see you next Monday. Tu es comme le vent qui fait chanter le violon et emporte au loin le parfum des roses. Caramel, bonbons et chocolat. Par moments, je ne te comprends pas. Merci pas pour moi, mais tu peux bien les offrir à une autre qui aime le vent et le parfum des roses. Moi, les mots tendres enrobés de douceur se posent sur ma bouche. Mais jamais sur mon cœur. Une parole encore. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Écoute-moi. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Je t'en prie. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Je te jure. Paroles, 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 paroles. Paroles encore des paroles. Que tu sais mon mot. Parler comme la première fois. Encore des mots, toujours des mots, les mêmes mots. Comme j'aimerais que tu me comprennes. Rien que des mots. Que tu m'écoutes au moins une fois. Des mots magiques, des mots tactiques qui sonnent faux. Tu es mon rêve défendu. Oui, tellement faux. Mon seul tourment et mon unique espérance. T'arrête quand tu commences. Si tu savais comme j'ai envie d'un peu de silence. Tu es pour moi la seule musique qui fait danser les étoiles sur les dunes. Caramel, bonbons et chocolat. Si tu n'existais pas déjà, je t'inventerais. Merci pas pour moi, mais tu peux bien les offrir à une autre. Étoiles sur les dunes. Moi, les mots tendres enrobés de douceur se posent sur ma bouche, mais jamais sur mon cœur. Encore un mot, juste une parole. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Écoute-moi. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Je t'en prie. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Je te jure. Tu es belle. Paroles, paroles, paroles. Que tu es belle.